Thank you, James. And welcome everybody to this session on the general data protection regulation, and the last session of the day as well. $1 billion, is that a lot of money? Maybe? It depends. Are you a consultant? or a lawyer? You can be one or the other, and it depends always works. It does. It depends on the context. So let's think about this in the context of the GDPR. $1 billion. So the fining authority under the General Data Protection Regulation is up to 4% of an organization's global top-line revenue. So for a company that has $25 billion of top-line revenue, like a Facebook, for example, or plenty of others, and others with bigger top-line revenue, that's the potential fine that companies of that size could face for violations of the GDPR. Okay, the fining structure, there's two tiers. It can be 2% of an organization's top-line revenue, or 10 million euro, whichever is greater, or 4% of the organization's top-line revenue, or 20 million euro, whichever is greater. Okay, so the reason I mention this is the stakes are pretty high financially. This is the attention getter, because at many organizations, when you start talking to business people and people in the C offices, if you will, about compliance, they get bored really fast, because it's not revenue generation and it's not cost cutting. It's avoidance of a cost from something bad happening. But they need to understand just how big these numbers are. Okay, a few other important reasons. Why does this matter? Why does the General Data Protection Regulation matter? Okay, first, it requires new IT and security capabilities, and we're going to talk a bit about some of the detail behind that. And new capabilities cost what? They cost money, and they potentially put other things at a lower priority as well. And again, what we're talking about here, high stakes, very important, but it's likely not going to be the first thing that's going to excite the chief marketing officer, the chief financial officer, the folks who are handling data analytics, and the like. From a pure business perspective, for those organizations that are doing business globally, doing business in the European Union, violations could result in the inability to be able to transfer personal data outside of the European Union. And you think about that. For many organizations, what would be the business impact if your data flows from the EU back to the US or other parts of the globe where you have operations were no longer permitted? Could potentially kill your European business. Non-compliance with the GDPR is also subject to individual lawsuits. That sounds like fun. Let's hire up the lawyers and go and litigate and respond to all these potential lawsuits from individuals who feel that, you know, we as an organization have done something inappropriate with their personal data and have somehow violated the GDPR. Investigations by regulators, if there are allegations or known instances of non-compliance with the GDPR, the data protection authorities in any of the various EU member states can initiate an investigation. And I've seen that from a firsthand experience, because data protection law, privacy law is not new in the European Union. GDPR is the new flavor of what's been in effect, the EU Data Protection Directive. These investigations can consume a lot of time, a lot of energy, and a lot of cost. And it diverts people from their day job of what they need to do to be able to participate in information gathering, in depositions, responding to inquiries and the like. And of course, if you have an instance where you have to admit where there is noncompliance with the data protection laws, you risk potential adverse media coverage. The media loves this stuff. It's like data breach. And once one media outlet picks up on it, then another, then another, then another. And then even as time goes on, and you become, your organization is sort of in the rear view mirror, if you will, in regards to the situation, you can still be referenced in current stories. So company ABC had some noncompliance with data protection law. Not unlike, and then they start to name your organization and all the others as well that have had issues. And lastly, the reputational damage that can come from all of that, which is generally degrading to customer trust as well. We heard a lot this morning at the keynote sessions about trust and how important trust is. Obviously, the focus was, you know, primarily from a security component, but absolutely true on the privacy side of things as well. Trust is absolutely instrumental to the privacy discussion, and having people that are in customers that are going to be comfortable sharing with your organization their personal data for the purposes in which you want to use it. So all of this, in addition, not just the financial aspect of things, but all of this is in play when you think about why does this even matter? Why is this a big deal? Okay, just a quick polling question. I think I probably have a sense for the background of the individuals in the room, but never like to assume, because this may help me in terms of shaping some of the comments that are to come. So just very quickly, by show of hands, so what's your interest in the GDPR? Are you responsible for security within your organization? Okay, probably half or so. A security consultant? Okay, it depends. That's probably where that answer came from, though. In-house or external legal counsel? Okay. Responsible for privacy? A lot of privacy people in the audience, great. Hopefully nobody's in the last category, those who were bored and had nothing else to do. So here you are. Before we talk about a bit more detail as to what the GDPR is all about and how it impacts IT, how it impacts security, I think it's important to just spend a few minutes on why. Why do the Europeans care so deeply about data privacy? And when I first got into data privacy back in 1999, I was at that time working for Marriott International, large company, had operations in many countries, including all of the EU countries. And that was when, at least at Marriott, there was the realization that, okay, the EU Data Protection Directive, which the GDPR replaced, the EU Data Protection Directive went into effect in 1995, and it was really the late 90s when many companies started to focus on what does this really mean? What are the requirements in this directive? The regulators are getting more vocal. Seems like we need to be doing something. So that was my entree into data privacy now almost 20 years ago. And at that time, I remember I was part of the law department reporting to the general counsel, not a lawyer, so I'm in this law department with 80 lawyers. And I remember some of the people there talking who at that time knew more about the Data Protection Directive than I did, that the Europeans view data privacy as a human right. And I took that very casually. I thought it was just sort of the, you know, casual use of terms. I didn't take it literally that they felt that data privacy was a human right until I went to my first International Data Protection Commissioners Conference, and they have one of those every year that move around the globe where data protection authorities from various countries, not just Europe, but other countries come together to talk about data privacy issues. And I heard regulators from the EU speak about why they feel so passionately about data privacy. And it really went back to World War II, where when you think about some of the things that were going on in Europe at that point in time, what data privacy meant to people of certain religions, certain health status, certain political affiliations. And that is really the root of the why they feel so passionately about this. So you'll hear people talk about privacy in Europe being viewed as a human right or a fundamental human right, not too much different than how we think about, say, freedom of speech in the US. So this is serious. This is not something they take casually. This is not a law that made its way, you know, through the legislative process just because it kind of felt good or something that should be there, but they feel very, very strongly about it. All right, so let's talk a bit more specifically about the GDPR. As I mentioned, data privacy or data protection regulation is not new in Europe. The EU Data Protection Directive that went into effect in 1995, the GDPR replaces that. Okay, the GDPR was issued last May of 2016, and it's effective in May of 2018. And the GDPR, like the EU Data Protection Directive, is all about personal data. Now, this may sound fairly basic, but I encounter this every day, working with clients of all sizes, in all industries and at all levels of sophistication, a really wide and dispersed and different understanding of what personal data is. If I'm talking to somebody in marketing, for example, chief marketing officer, his or her understanding of what personal data can be very different than what it is at the CIO level or CISO or any other part of the organization for that matter. And it really is important when we talk about and think about the GDPR to be crystal clear as to what the definition of personal data is. And it is defined specifically in the GDPR. It's included in Appendix A of the slides. Because if you don't understand and you don't have a consistent understanding of what personal data is across the organization, your chances of compliance, or your risk of non-compliance, I should say, with the GDPR is going to track directly that inconsistent understanding. So when you think about the GDPR and you think about personal data, think very broadly, because essentially the way the Europeans have defined personal data is essentially any data that can be attributed back to an identified or identifiable individual is considered personal data. Now, some people think, well, I can go on Google and I can find your email address and I can find your date of birth, I can find all these things out about you, so that can't be personal data. It's all personal data. Just because it may reside in other places that are publicly accessible does not make it not personal data. So things like IP addresses and identifiers that are used are considered personal data. Okay, the GDPR, it is a big document, and in the appendices, there's a link to it. If you want to read all 200 pages of it, it's there for your reading. There's 99 articles that are part of the GDPR, and Article 32 is the article that deals with security, which kind of speaks to most of the people in the audience. It's 135 words, Article 32. And you'll see in a subsequent slide, it is not very specific about exactly what has to be done from a security perspective. Okay, within the GDPR, there are a number of requirements that are very similar to what is currently in effect under the EU Data Protection Directive, but there are differences as well. So, the game has been raised, so to speak, in terms of the requirements and how comprehensive and onerous, depending on your point of view, some of those requirements are. Okay, first is, as they talk about in the directive, territorial scope. or extraterritorial scope. So no matter where you are located in the world, if you are collecting, processing, somehow handling personal data related to an EU citizen, the GDPR applies. So you may be a business sitting here in San Francisco. You have no presence in Europe, but you're interacting with, you're transacting business with EU citizens. The GDPR will apply. Another really big deal, and this isn't necessarily for security folks to figure out, security professionals, it does affect IT and engineering to some extent, and that is consent. And the consent that's required under the GDPR is explicit consent. So a good way maybe to think about this is, gone are the days where you present this 10,000 word, you know, end user license agreement or terms and conditions or privacy statement or however it's being wrapped, and sort of force a person through it to click, you know, I accept, or have something pre-clicked, even worse yet. It now needs to be a less conditioned consent, and it has to be more more clear and more conspicuous. So this is going to be a big deal, getting over and meeting the consent requirement in the GDPR. And the whole notion there is that, you know, nobody's trying to prohibit businesses from collecting and using personal data, but the whole notion is power to the people. That person should understand what's being collected, how it's going to be used, and give you their permission to be able to do that. All right, within the GDPR, unlike the EU Data Protection Directive, there's also an age gate. So for individuals under the age of 16 years old, they cannot give you, they cannot express their consent. That needs to be from a parent or from a guardian. So for those that might be familiar with the Children's Online Privacy Protection Act, COPPA, here in the States, essentially you'd need to have verifiable parental or guardian consent before collecting and using the personal data of an individual that's under the age of 16. Might have some systems change implications, depending on your business and whether or not you're even doing business with individuals who age gating might be an issue for you. Individual rights, as I mentioned, GDPR is all about power to the people. Now, a number of these individual rights are currently in the EU Data Protection Directive. As an individual, you have the right to be able to request access to your personal data, to request that it be changed if it's incomplete, inaccurate, the request to have it be deleted or erasure, as it's referred to in the GDPR, or this notion of the right to be forgotten. I hate you. I never want you to have any of my information. Delete it all. And also, this new concept of data portability. Whereas a data collector or data controller, I now have the responsibility to be able to provide all of your personal data back to you, to somebody else, some other organization perhaps, of your choice. So think about the system implications of potentially that. I mean, just trying to find, in many organizations, when these requests come in, it's always a nail biter, because a lot of organizations, what they're doing is they're looking at it saying, oh my gosh, you know, we got this data in 20 different places. Now we got to go back and figure out how to, you know, how to access it all, how to bundle it all up. If the person comes back and says, hey, this is incorrect, and let me show you the proof it's incorrect, then going back to all these data locations and updating that data, there's some major implications to that. And then lastly, again, this is sort of a macro picture. This isn't trying to capture all the requirements in the 200 pages of the GDPR and the 99 articles, but this requirement for data breach notification. So the requirement is within 72 hours, if you have a data breach, that you would notify the applicable and appropriate data protection authorities. And under certain circumstances, there's also the requirement to notify the affected individual as well. So in some ways, not so different than what we have right now in the US with all these various state data breach laws, where you have to notify individuals if certain triggers are met, you have to notify certain state attorneys general in some cases, if certain information is affected within particular states. So now, you know, where some would say the Europeans were maybe ahead of the US in terms of data privacy and data protection legislation, this was an area where the US had laws before the EU as it relates to breach notification. All right, so what does this really mean to security, to IT? And again, as part of a compliance strategy in many organizations, this is going to be a team effort. It's going to need collaboration between security, IT, the privacy function, the marketing organization, and others for that matter. So first, this extraterritorial or territorial scope, and as it relates to individual rights. I mean, think about this today in your own organization. I mean, do you have the processes in place? Do you have the system capabilities to be able to relatively efficiently process these data access requests, data correction requests, data deletion requests? Data portability now as well. Could you bundle all that personal data about an individual and present it back to them, him or her? A lot of organizations don't. And the reason for that right now is that the number of these sorts of requests at many organizations is relatively small. I mean, you might get a handful of these a year, and when you get them, it isn't pretty, but you figure out a way, you brute force through it, and you get the data you need to get, you report it back out, or you delete it, or you correct it, whatever, you know, whatever's being requested by the individual. But I think what's going to happen, and I'm seeing this at some clients right now, is the number of these requests are getting greater already. And not just the number, but sort of the intelligence behind them as well. You can tell by the requests that the person understands what their rights are. And in some cases, they're citing laws and sections of laws. So it's no longer, you know, sort of the curious or the person who's just saying, ah, as a matter of principle, I'm going to go ahead and ask them to show me all the personal data about me. It seems like now it's shifting to, you know, people, their awareness is higher, they care about this, and they're exercising their rights. Okay, data breach notification. Again, you know, for multinational companies, this is nothing new. For U.S. companies, for sure. Because we have this patchwork of state data breach laws already, but you really need to have a incident response plan that not only helps you manage through the incident in an efficient way and minimizing damage, but also now for your European operations, you need data operations wherever you have personal data related to EU citizens. You need to make sure that you're going to be able to detect and then report those incidents within 72 hours to regulators. And again, under certain circumstances, you'll need to notify affected individuals as well. So incident response planning, generally just a good thing for every organization dealing with personal data to have in place, but now there's additional reason to do that. So the third point, thinking about security, I mentioned in the 99 articles in the GDPR, Article 32 deals with security. It's 135 words. Not a whole lot there in terms of what's in those 135 words. Basically says, you're going to use reasonable measures as appropriate to ensure the confidentiality, integrity, and availability of information based on risk. And also you'll have some resiliency built in as well. So the wording itself, not to minimize at all that rather abbreviated approach to it, but, and it's not too dissimilar to what's in the EU Data Protection Directive, leaves it pretty wide open. You know, what is reasonable? What is appropriate? That potentially opens the door for a lot of second guessing when something goes wrong as to whether or not something really was reasonable or appropriate. Two things that are mentioned specifically in the security article are encryption and pseudonymization. Talk about definitions mattering, pseudonymization. There's a term you don't hear quite every day. And there's another aspect that is not in the GDPR that I think should be in that security article, and that is tokenization as well. So encryption and pseudonymization, and if I had my way, tokenization, would all be in there, well, two of them already are, in the context of these are measures that the GDPR suggests organizations be taking to protect personal data. So encryption is nothing new. Tokenization is nothing new necessarily. This notion of pseudonymization, where you're parsing personal data to essentially make it less identified and storing separately the data that could re-identify it and controlling access and protecting the two, is another possibility from a security perspective that the GDPR holds out there as a way to sort of demonstrate or practice good security. The other thing before I talk about PDD, when we're thinking about security, got to think about the whole ecosystem. Got to think about the whole ecosystem for GDPR generally. And what I mean by that is your service providers, your partners, if you're in the cloud, you know, wherever this personal data is that your organization has collected, and whoever you're sharing it with that's providing whatever service they're providing, you're responsible for that. So the important thing I think there is that you take control over your destiny as it relates to that data. So I would suggest you don't necessarily want to be relying on your service provider saying, well, you know, they're the best of breed in this particular, you know, service area. I'm sure it's all fine. You want to really verify that it is fine. And in the area of encryption, another thing that I suggest to organizations, obviously you can take your own approach, but that you control the keys as well. You don't have your cloud service provider do that. All right, PBD, getting ahead of myself here. Privacy by design, or as they refer to it in the GDPR, data protection impact assessments. Has anybody ever done a privacy impact assessment or data protection impact assessment? Okay, a handful of people have. All right, this is now within the GDPR. Makes perfect sense, you know, just like in security, there's also the corollary on the privacy side of things that you build it in to new systems, new processes, new product offerings. You don't try and bolt it on after the fact or figure out how to get it there, you know, 2 days before a product or system launch, but that be done. Now, what is a little different or unique and concerning in some ways about this privacy by design notion in the GDPR is that if you go through this process and you're evaluating, you know, all the privacy, the data protection risk for this new system or product, you know, as it's being developed and engineered, and the conclusion of that is that there is high risk that has not been mitigated, then you're to have a conversation with the affected data protection authorities in those particular countries. And what do you think comes of that? Probably nothing good. Might be an interesting discussion, but so no organization wants to, you know, have to go to a data protection authority and say, hey, you know what, we're developing this new great system and we went through the data protection impact assessment as required under the GDPR, and our conclusion is it's a high risk and we can't mitigate that. Well, you know, that's not a good answer. So the bottom line there is you have to figure out a way to address those privacy risks so that you can defend and you feel comfortable in good faith that the risk is something other than high, so you're not going to a data protection authority and having that conversation. Okay, the other thing that is required in the security component in Article 32 is that there be periodic testing of security controls. So, you know, whether that's done internally through internal audit or some other function in the organization, or you bring in a third party auditor or assessor to do that work is totally up to you. But the important point is that there be some periodic testing so you know that not only what you have designed to address security risk is in place, but it's actually operating effectively. You need both pieces. Okay, so as it relates to security, if you're hoping that in the GDPR, that it's something like, let's say, for example, the payment card industry data security standard, the PCI standard that has, you know, 300 plus thou shalls and thou shall nots, you're not going to find it in the GDPR. Good news is, from that, gives you flexibility, you know, to be creative. It doesn't put you in a box saying you must do this all the time because it's number 28 on this particular checklist or within this particular article. Okay, the right to be forgotten. I just thought I would share with you. This was a number that I heard somebody from Google throw out at a conference some time ago. And obviously, they're different in terms of what they're doing and why people might be a little more interested in what they're doing with their personal data versus many other organizations. But the number I heard is 600,000 requests from individuals to be forgotten. Again, this right to be forgotten. So again, many organizations aren't going to probably realize anywhere near that number of requests, but it does beg the question, when they come in, how are they going to be handled? You know, correct. 600,000 requests. So you think about that. I mean, just the intake process, where do those go? I mean, when you get emails or you get telephone calls or you get letters or however they may come in, where's that going to go and how is that going to be processed? So again, while most organizations will get nowhere near that sort of volume for sure, you have to be prepared though. You have to have a plan and a way to be able to handle those requests because this is a legal right. And I'll tell you from my personal experience, you know, in my past life and working with clients more currently, it never ceases to amaze me how a single person can create quite the stir when he or she does not feel that they are being taken seriously and they are not responded to in a complete and timely and a full manner. And one person can start a spiral that will consume more time, more energy, and more costs than you ever anticipated. Yes, a question. Okay, so the question or the point was, again, the notion of right to be forgotten, manufacturing company have employees that might feel they have the right or would need to be forgotten. Well, you wouldn't have to comply with that. So you do have, as the organization receiving those requests, you have some rights as well, you know, as to whether or not you have to comply with that. So for example, in the employee context, yeah, I mean, the government's requiring you to maintain certain information about that individual. You need it to be able to administer, you know, payroll benefits, things like that. There may be reasons in the consumer perspective why you need to keep that data to maintain your books and records. You just can't, you know, delete all of your sales transaction information that support whatever numbers are appearing in financial statements and tax returns and the like. Yes, another question. Right.
Versus business to business. So if I'm providing a service to another business, does that business and their customers, does it flow all the way to myself? And I have to be able to respond to those, that third party? Their customers are employees, for instance?
Yeah, so you're talking about essentially information, personal data that you may have about a contact. Correct.
And how does that apply to me if I'm dealing directly with the business and not necessarily with the end user?
So the key is, and I'm not sure this will answer your question, but we can also take it offline as well. You know, it's, as I mentioned earlier, it's all about personal data. So if that personal data is coming to you in a role where you're the data processor, you know, as opposed to a data controller where you're collecting it directly, or in this case, not collecting it directly, you have accountability, you know, for that data. So if an individual said, okay, I'm doing business with company A, but I also know company B has my personal data as well because company A uses company B to do certain things for them as part of their business process, and they want to be forgotten, exercise their right to be forgotten, it would cascade, you know, downstream. So this ecosystem is quite large. You can't just think about this in the context of, you know, your own business and what data you're taking in directly, but you have to think about it in terms of all the vendors you're using as part of your business processes, cloud providers, you know, whatever the case may be. Wherever that personal data is going, that's the important thing. Okay, I got the 10-minute sign here. I'm probably less than that now. Okay, so first, a few things here in terms of, again, this is a sliver of the GDPR. We've been kind of focusing primarily thinking about how this impacts security and IT, potential IT changes, et cetera. First thing you really need to do is, as I mentioned earlier, make sure there's a consistent understanding of personal data, because if you don't have that throughout the organization, then it's hard to, you know, it's hard to be applying the requirements and the rules to that data if it's not properly identified. So understanding all the data flows, and that goes to the ecosystem point of within the organization and between the organization and service providers, cloud providers that you're using. Be mindful of shadow IT. It's still live and well. Those who don't feel well served by their IT departments find other ways to get things done, and generally that's not always very well known. Okay, determine if you can differentiate between the within your systems the personal data related to EU citizens and the personal data pertaining to others, because again, GDPR applies to the personal data of EU citizens. There may be system changes that are going to be necessary to meet the new consent requirements to handle these data access requests, data deletion requests, age gating requirements. If you have individuals that your organization is doing business with that you would expect are going to be 16 or younger. Also, a small caveat, or not so small caveat on that point, is each of the EU member states has the authority to be able to lower that age gate to age 13. Okay, so what we may end up with is this patchwork of some countries saying, okay, 16, we'll go with GDPR, others saying, no, I think 13 is more appropriate. So these can drive, you know, these can drive system changes, which requires budget and requires planning. Okay, assessing the adequacy of security measures. Again, Article 32 is not terribly explicit, but you have to be able to defend whatever approach you're taking. Whether you're basing your security practices on the ISO model or any other model, there should be a rationale for what you're doing, and you should be willing to defend that, you know, if security came into question by any regulators. And then developing or implementing, again, we mentioned these are included explicitly in the GDPR, encryption and pseudonymization of personal data. And the definitions matter, and the definitions are in the appendices as well. But I've always been, in my past life, was always a firm believer in encryption, well-managed encryption. If I could only do one thing as it related to security, that was my go-to. So I would just encourage you there that as you think about the adequacy of your current security, whether you're really using encryption to the extent that you can, again, including your cloud instances and cloud providers as well. And I'll just share, for those of you in the healthcare space that are dealing with protected health information, Health and Human Services, while encryption is still an addressable requirement in the HIPAA security framework, they're kind of beyond that. Their point of view is everybody should be encrypting that PHI. So, just as an aside for those who are in the healthcare space. All right, the data protection impact assessment process, or privacy by design, you may or may not have something like that already in place in the organization. I see many organizations that do not have that in place currently. So that's a requirement. So you're going to have to figure out, you know, what does that checklist look like? What does that process look like? Who are the players who need to be part of that data protection impact assessment process? How are we going to operationalize it and govern it and manage it? And lastly, the data breach response plan. Okay, so achieving compliance is, you know, going to vary by organization. For those organizations that feel very comfortable that they're currently in compliance with the EU Data Protection Directive, to go from the directive to the GDPR, there's work, there's new requirements that are part of that, but it's going to be more manageable, obviously, than an organization that isn't currently in compliance with the data protection law, with the EU Data Protection Directive. And ultimately, it comes down to a matter of planning and resources and the will to achieve compliance. And we are, you know, as of today, we're 465 days from the effective date of the GDPR, which is May 25th, 2018. Now, some of the things that are going to need to happen within the organization as it relates to systems and consents and, you know, everything else that's required, it's going to have budget implications. So here we are in February of 2017. For most organizations and on a calendar year basis, your budgets are set. So if you haven't already figured out, you know, what the impact of GDPR is to the organization, at least for the parts and the operations that you're responsible for and you control budget for, you may have missed your window for 2017, and now you have to look forward to the next budget cycle, which does not give you much time at all to get there between the beginning January of 2018 and May 25th of 2018. All right, just very quickly, at a lot of organizations we always encounter, well, what are others doing? Somebody else must have solved this problem. What are our peers doing? What are our competitors doing? So this was from a survey that was published by Hunton and Williams and AvPoint, and this is just one slide out of that, but the reason I included it was the second to the bottom entry there around data security and breach notifications. So for those who were part of this survey and were asked to respond, fully compliant, process underway, or neutral, I think neutral probably is, we don't have a clue, or at least a good clue yet, this is how it broke out. So only 37% of, you know, those responding to this felt that they were, you know, fully compliant with the security and data breach requirements, and another 30% underway, 33% that were neutral. So to the extent that you're in one of those organizations where somebody says, hear this a lot, well, you know, we're not the first to have to figure this out. I'm sure there's some solution we can leverage. No, not always. Okay, that concludes the slides and my remarks. As I mentioned, there is an appendix to these slides as well, which has some useful links to the GDPR itself, some surveys, some other tools, data protection laws around the globe as well. While we're talking about GDPR in Europe, there are, you know, other geographies that have data protection laws that have consequence as well. So there's a link to a legal guide in the appendix and some key definitions that you'll want to take a look at as well if you really need to immerse into this. Question, yes? Yep, so the question was whether or not there's going to be a GDPR certification kind of similar to PCI. There's nothing that I've heard of along those lines. No discussion I've heard or body that's come forward saying, hey, we will do GDPR compliance certifications. Yeah, so the question was for individuals who request, say, data deletion of their personal data, whether or not they have to be provided with some certificate or, you know, other documents saying that's the case. So the GDPR is not specific on that. You know, it doesn't require that be the case. I mean, What many organizations do, and again, this is not a new right for individuals. It exists under the EU Data Protection Directive as well. Is generally they'll return a letter, you know, to the individual or email, communicate somehow saying that they've processed, they've complied with a request to close that loop. And just an important side about that is that, you know, the documentation of all those requests, how they're processed, and the disposition of them. That all should be documented and all should be maintained as well, because again, we've seen multiple instances where a single individual can create quite the stir when they feel something wasn't handled properly or timely. Another question in back. Yeah, so this is intended to be all-encompassing. The intent with the GDPR, like it was with the EU Data Protection Directive, was that it would harmonize data protection law across the EU. That wasn't always the case under the EU Data Protection Directive, and the regulators realized that if each member country or each member state is saying, yes, all this, and also, you know, here's a nuance for us because we think that particular thing is important, you know, it makes it a bit more difficult. Although I have to say they do have some ability to, you know, to do that even with the GDPR. Yeah, remains to be seen. I think it's probably going to be per country. Okay, I've got the stop sign here, but I'm happy to hang out and answer any other additional questions. James, any closing comments or notes before everybody sets free? Well, thank you everyone for your time. Appreciate it. Hope this was helpful.